I. We're Arlene and Al Bonadonna from Brooklyn, New York. And this is the Rosie O'Donnell Show. On today's show, Nicole Kidman, Kids Talking with Rosie, and Emmy Lou Harris, Linda Ronstadt, and Dolly Parton.
And hit it, John!
Same here, Rosie.
You're here celebrating something special?
Yes.
Oh, yes.
You know how you got here?
Yes.
Your daughter.
I know.
Your daughter wrote us a letter. Alicia, she wrote us a letter. Dear Ms. O'Donnell. I always love when they address me formally like that. Dear Ms. O'Donnell.
She doesn't know you.
She doesn't. You can say Rosie. Anyone can call me Rosie. You know where I live in my building? The guys who work there. Hello, Ms. O'Donnell. I guess I stopped them. I'm like, listen, it's Rosie! It's sweet of me, isn't it? Okay, anyway. We get this letter from your daughter. It says, Dear Miss O'Donnell, yadda yadda yadda, my parents' 50th anniversary is February 13th, 1999. 50th wedding anniversary. When I visited my family in November, I asked my mom what she wanted for her anniversary, and her response was, I don't want a party. I don't want old home week with my friends. I don't want to go on a cruise. She said, well, what do you want, Ma? I want to go on the Rosie O'Donnell Show.
Wow.
So here you are.
Rosie O'Donnell Show.
Thank you.
Now, why did you want to come here to Rockefeller Center?
Well,
go ahead. Well, we're childhood sweethearts.
Yeah.
And when we got married, we had very little money. And this is where we spent our honeymoon, walking around.
Walking around Rockefeller Center.
Yes.
And now you're inside in the studio on TV.
My whole dream.
Sorry, Alan.
My whole dream was to be on your show, and she knew that. And
The dream came true.
That was so sweet that she wrote you the letter, isn't it? Other shows right now, what they do is, you know, she's not actually been to Wisconsin. She's here. We didn't do that. She's not here. Because that would have been good, but we didn't do it.
That's
okay. Sorry. She couldn't come. I don't know. She was busy. But so you're having a party? You're not even having a party?
No,
you're not having a party at all?
This is our whole party.
This is your party here? My show? Even though I'm working on this in therapy, that, you know, when people tell you what they want, you should just do what they want. You shouldn't do what you think they want because you don't really know what they want. You should let them have their own feelings.
Don't do it.
Yeah, I spend $150 a week trying to learn how to do that. Obviously, it's not working. We thought we would throw you a party right out here in the hallway. So we set up the hallway. Look at the monitor there. We thought you could have a party without your friends. So we invited a couple of your friends. Come on in. to do. Look at you looking at yourself on TV. How cute are you? She gets right in front of the camera. She goes, I watch you every day.
I tried to get you on one on the telephone.
Oh, Rosie.
All right, now listen. You said you didn't want a party. We got you a party. You said you didn't want a cruise. You're going on an 8-day cruise. Your friends, well, it's all home week. Here's your friends. Go out, enjoy your party. I gotta do my job. Get out, go out, Ollie. Get out. Hi. Hi, sweetie girl. Go on that way. Hi, how are you? Hi, buddy. How are you? He's okay. Go down. You're welcome. God bless you. Happy Valentine's. Don't cry. It's okay. It's all right. Go have a party. I'll be after. Say hi to John McDean of the DLC. Valentine's
that is,
show.
That is fantastic.
But isn't it sad that the one, Alicia, she couldn't come, she has pneumonia.
She really does.
Yeah, she's in Wisconsin. So Alicia, who's watching, I'm sure, you made your parents very happy, although I thought that your aunt was gonna have a heart attack. But aside from that, everyone was good. Well, that's so sweet.
Really
How
great.
Are you, John? Happy Valentine's Day to you.
Back at you.
How are
Back
you?
I'm doing great.
Yeah.
Doing great, yep.
What'd you do last night?
Must-see TV night at my house.
Yeah.
First of all, the most hilarious Frasier was on last night.
Really?
So David Hyde Pierce cracks me up big time. And Kelsey was great. And ER was amazing.
Well, here's the thing.
Amazing, yeah.
Fell asleep at 9:15.
You did?
Yes.
Yeah.
But I did tape it.
Okay.
Well, I did not watch the Frasier yet.
Okay.
Because I had to only watch one show during makeup.
Gotcha.
I watched my ER.
Gotcha.
Very upsetting.
Yeah.
Very upsetting. Why? Because Carter is making out with the girl.
I know.
He got a hickey. He's got a girlfriend. I don't enjoy that. I'd like to tell the producers of ER, bad enough Clooney's leaving. Don't do the new intern with Carter. We've had enough of interns doing things they shouldn't
yes,
in this
we
country.
Are. Yes, we
don't
are.
Want it.
Oi.
Speaking of which, the impeachment trial is over now, okay. Supposedly. Right? Today, at 12 o'clock, 2 hours from now, they're supposed to announce whatever, you know. Now they're going to say Janet Reno supposedly is going to investigate Ken Starr about his improper handling of Monica Lewinsky.
Oh, no.
It seems no matter who's on trial, it's always about the improper handling of Monica Lewinsky. Do you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
And then did you see this morning on the Today Show they had Linda Tripp? Do you know what's interesting is that you would want her to be a moron. Do you know what I mean? You'd like her to go on the Today Show and go, hey, I taped her too bad. I'm gonna do a book. But she didn't.
No.
She's this articulate woman who, here's my theory of the whole clip. 2 minutes? Oh my God, I have so many great things. So I have 2 minutes? Oh, Rose, geez, there's so much stress on me.
Oh my God.
I'll try to say it fast. I think it's like a Rorschach's test or whatever, that ink blot thing. You know, you hold it up and you see whatever you've lived.
Right.
That's the whole thing with the Clinton trial. I think Linda Tripp felt obviously betrayed and something in her life so that she's like making a misjudgment. You know, I don't think she's innately a bad person. So just, I think she made a bad judgment based, you know what I mean? I realize that my displeasure with the president has to do with other issues in my life, not him specifically. I still am very unhappy with him and I'm working it through, but I don't enjoy him anymore. I really don't, frankly, you know, and I know it's mildly irrational and people have argued with me about it, but you don't have to be rational any time to be, no. This is very irrational Jerry Falwell, who is a reverend, but I don't like to say Reverend Jerry Falwell, because he's very unreverend-like to me.
Indeed.
But anyway,
Indeed.
He is on there now.
Totally.
Did you hear his new thing?
Yes.
He's saying that Tinky Winky, the Teletubby, is gay.
I know.
The Teletubby Tinky Winky is gay. This is what he's saying. What is next? The Count has satanic overtones.
Oh, right.
Oh, yes. Did you see the way he's got the fangs and the blood? Obviously, devil worshiping going on there.
Right.
The Weebles, they wobble, but they don't fall down. All alcoholics. All of them. All the Weebles, alcoholics. Cast for the friendly ghost, white supremacist.
Oh, must be.
You never see any black ghosts around Cast, but do
no
you?
Way.
No, no, no. You'd think, you know, this guy says he's got a direct line to God. Can you imagine God phoning Jerry Falwell? Jerry, it's me, God. Lot of problems going down there on Earth. Basically, start with the Teletubby. That tinky-winky thing is really annoying me up here, Jerry.
Bad news. Oh,
so ridiculous.
Crazy.
And it's on the news.
I know.
Jerry Falwell also, Rorschach's test. I think he's had a lot of pain in his childhood. I do. I don't think he's living the spirit of love. I don't.
Doesn't feel like it, no.
He's not doing the old Christ live and let live
exactly.
thing. He's not being pious. He's being a bitter, mean person. That's what I think.
There you
I don't
go.
Know. What are you holding up? What? I missed the sign. I missed the sign. 30 seconds. Okay. What are we giving away? Lots of stuff. A chocolate Swatch watch from Swatch. Smells like chocolate for Valentine's Day. A rose. Just a rose? Yeah. From Professional Florist for everyone. Cool. And you know, Godiva has a great promotion every year where they give this huge diamond in one of their boxes of chocolate that's
oh, yes.
like this. So we gave each of you a box of chocolate. You might have the diamond. I'm not sure. Go buy one. It's great chocolate. Is that enough? Did I say enough about Godiva? Okay, good. I'll sing a little song. Lady Godiva, children at your feet. Commercial, I know! You know who's here?
Wow, do I.
Call me, can you hear me?
Nicole. Also, Dolly Parton, Emmy Lou Harris, Linda Ronstadt. They're singing together again. They're first. Okay, commercial. I gotta go. Lisa Jenks jewelry up on eBay. I autographed it with a pen. I can't even talk about it. Lisa Jenks, thank you. She's a very, very prominent, expensive jewelry person. eBay.com. Goodbye. We'll be back with Nicole Kidman. I am in trouble. I went too long. To die for and her extremely unusual relationship with my husband. Currently, she can be seen starring on Broadway in The Blue Room, a role critics have called pure theatrical Viagra. Please welcome the one and only Nicole Kidman.
Suit and I'm in a blue suit.
Yeah, that's good, right?
The American flag, right?
We're coordinated.
Yeah.
You and I. It matches your eyes. Mine hopefully does not match my eyes.
But I have onion breath, don't I?
Have you?
Mm.
What did you eat?
Onions.
Right before my show?
Yeah.
Thanks
I
very
think so.
Much.
Do
Jeez.
I?
Let me smell. Get closer. Let me just smell. I'll tell you. You totally do. Have an Altoid. Have an Altoid. It's all right.
Give me.
Listen, women don't look as good as you could have bad breath. No one cares. Face reality. I got one too.
Coffee
okay.
and onions.
Yeah, that's a strange breakfast you had. Just a big old onion.
No, no, I had bagel with the salmon. You know, smoked salmon and onions on.
You know what I don't like? You know why I don't like smoked salmon?
Why?
Because it looks to me like tongue. I know
what?
That it's. I know it's fish, but when I look at it, it looks like tongue, so I can't eat it.
That's disgusting. Now I don't think I can eat it.
I just ruined it for you. But think of the breath I've saved you. You know what I mean? Because chances are you wouldn't just have bagels and onion.
Mm.
No. You must be very, very tired, although you don't look tired, from doing 8 shows a week, The Blue Room at the Court Theater. And Nicole, I saw it, and you were so fabulous in this. You really, really were. But it is tiring, is it not?
It is. I've been doing, this is my 6th month, coming up to my 6th month, because we did it in London, and then we brought it into New York. And there's only 2 of us in the show, so.
It's exhausting.
Yeah.
And you only have 1 day off.
Yeah, we have Monday. You only have 1 day off too, right?
No, we have the weekends, both days.
Oh.
But I did.
Oh, God, I'm hopeless.
But you know, that's all right. You're busy. You don't have time to watch. But
it... I do watch.
You watch?
Yes, yes. Because I have my days free.
Oh, really?
Except on Wednesdays and Saturdays. I don't have, I work, do 2 shows on Wednesday, 2
yeah,
shows on
matinees.
Saturdays.
Yeah, the matinees. But you don't see the show often, do you?
I see it enough.
Oh, no.
Yes. I see what you say about
no,
me.
No, I don't say. Nick! What? I don't say anything. What are you talking about?
I exist, Rosie.
What do you mean?
I do exist.
Quiet, everyone. I don't say anything. You have no proof, is the point of the story.
Oh, really? I have a tape.
You do not. Tape.
I do.
You have a tape of what?
Of you refusing to acknowledge my existence.
That is so horribly mean.
Ask,
we don't have time to roll
here.
It.
Ask,
we don't
ask
have time to roll it.
Because we don't.
Did
Why?
You really bring them?
Yeah. Mm. Ask them.
Roll it. Because I don't remember the female star.
You do?
But,
I do.
Who was that?
Nicole Kidman.
Oh, whatever.
Nicole, but she's Australian. I don't know.
Oh, Kidman. Is she
oh,
in
yes.
this?
Oh, yes, she's in.
Nice. Nicole,
call me
Nicole kind of writes
Oops,
him.
Sorry.
Yeah, sorry. He has a nanny for his children named Nicole.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
I'm glad they got a nanny.
Yeah.
It's hard for him being a single dad and working and everything.
Exactly.
Do you know that Nicole Kidman, who you worked with in Malice?
Yes.
She's married to my boyfriend.
I know.
She's married to Tom Cruise.
She is?
Yeah.
I didn't even know that.
Yeah.
And I saw her naked on stage, and I started crying because she's that perfect. Yeah. And I know you have a problem with...
I'm very kind to you in real life, aren't I?
Very, very kind.
Did you get my flowers I sent you opening night?
No. No, I did. Yes.
Oh, you did. Oh, I felt bad.
Yes, and you commented on my ass.
Well, you're
a sounds weird when you say that with my accent. I should say it American. Ass, right?
Yeah.
Ass.
But here's the thing. You were a nudie patootie.
So rude.
Well, I didn't want to not acknowledge that I saw your butt because I thought...
Okay, you don't have to tell everybody.
I wrote nice acting, nice accent, nice ass. That's what I wrote. Because it was nice. All three were great. Were you nervous? No, honestly, they told you you're going to be in this new play, great play. It really is a great play. And that you had to be a nudie patootie. What did you say?
No, I'm only nude from behind.
That's why I said nice ass.
No, because we actually discovered that in rehearsals.
You mean it wasn't written in the play?
No.
Really?
Well, obviously the play's about sex. Right. So sometimes you have sex with your clothes off, right? So.
Yes. But you
not often. No,
But you volunteered to be nude is the point you're making.
No, no. Here's what happened. The man who's in the play with me, he plays a character called... We play five different characters each. He plays a character at one stage who's a playwright who he thought would walk around naked,
which is
probably true, right?
And he does a cartwheel.
Do we know a lot of playwrights that walk around naked?
Right.
But, you know, very bohemian. And so he does a naked cartwheel and all this stuff. So I thought, well, if he does it, then I have to match it. Otherwise, it looks like I'm, you know, I don't know. Anyway, so that's how it came about.
So you did
volunteer.
That's the point.
It's very embarrassing. I
didn't
volunteer. It just sort of happened from the character.
Yeah.
It came from a very pure.
Now, honestly, first time, were you nervous? Were you nervous doing it? Because, I mean.
Absolutely terrified.
You were, yeah.
I wouldn't take off anything in rehearsals all the way through. They kept teasing me about it. Because I'd be like, no, it's not the right time. We don't need to do it today. And then we did rehearsals and it sort of just happened very organically. And it's a very small section of it.
And it's not definitely the focal point
but
of the play.
But it's strange because when you're actually in the character in the play, I'm not aware that there's 1,000 people out there watching it.
Really?
And then afterwards, sometimes I go, oh my gosh, I can't believe.
They
saw
my
butt every night.
Exactly. And when I was leaving the theater that night, there was all the crews there, entertainment crews, because I saw you opening up. And they're like, you know, what do you think? I'm like, I'm replacing her as soon as she leaves the show. It's going to be me, my saggy butt up there nude. I turn around and go, hi, everybody. Whatever. I wouldn't have been able to do it. Even if I was really skinny, I still wouldn't do it, because I think I'd be so embarrassed.
I get embarrassed. Yes, it is embarrassing.
Although,
but
you know
once you are in the character, it's far less, you know, in a play, the great thing about doing is a play is that you can get lost in it.
Right.
From the minute you start, you become so involved in what you're doing that you forget that there's an audience out there.
That's if you're a good actress like you. Because when I did Broadway, I was speaking to my friends who were in the audience during the show. I swear to you, Nicole, I would see a friend of mine, I'd be doing the hand drive, born to hand drive. Go to Joellen's.
We had somebody in the audience actually the other night calling out, talking to the characters.
Really?
Yes. Yelling out, actually not to me, yelling out things to Ian Glenn, the other guy, about what he should do to me.
Really? And what did you do? What did you do?
I thought, that's when I was not lost in the character. I got a little bit scared.
I'll bet. Mm. New York audiences, you know, this is true.
Well, he was yelling, you know, he was being complimentary. He was not yelling out obscenities, but it was still...
They don't realize.
Yelling really loud, and the whole audience, shh, people started to...
Yeah, it's not audience participation. No. You want to tell them.
But then sometimes they give me flowers at the end of the show, like someone will run up and give. So
oh, that's
quite
sweet,
nice.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
Did you always want to do Broadway when you were... Well, you know, we'll take a break and you tell me that. We're going to talk more with Nicole Kidman after the break. Don't go away. Nicole Kidman, who's starring in The Blue Room at the Court Theater. No tickets available from the moment it opened, true or false?
True. Yeah, no,
yeah,
true.
Yeah, they sold out through the whole run.
Yes, we're very lucky.
Now, did you always dream...
Thank you, people.
Yeah, did you always dream of doing a Broadway show? Was that...
I did theatre when I was in Australia, and I love doing theatre, but I hadn't had the chance to. I hadn't done anything in 11 years. And then when we were in London doing Eyes Wide Shut, I met Sam Mendes, who's the artistic director of the Donmar Warehouse, which is an experimental theatre in London, and that's how it all eventuated.
And when you started it over there, was there plans to take it here all the time?
No.
No.
We were just going to do 6 weeks in this little tiny 200-seat theatre. And it was just so that I could play, you know, have fun and experiment.
Was it daunting to come to New York to bring it in?
Yeah.
Yes. Were you nervous? You did not look nervous opening there.
Quite terrifying. I wasn't nervous in England at all. And then when I came to New York and we'd had all the hype from London, and suddenly I was in New York, I went, what am I doing? I've made a huge mistake. Oh. I'm terrified. And I got my, you know, before the show where you almost throw up.
Right, right. You know, is it true what I read?
Well,
in the
you
paper?
Know, you've done it. New York's tough too.
Listen, there was no Heine thing. I wasn't that nervous. If it was the Heine thing, I might have thrown up too. It was just me doing, you know, there are worse things I can do. And trust me, it was off key and most people ask for a refund. Anyway, is it true that my Tommy did not sit in the audience so that he wouldn't distract? People told me
in London. No, he did sit in the audience a couple of times and he did distract. So then he decided, I'm not going to sit in the audience. Well, because people would sort of look at him and look at me on the stage and look at him to see how he's reacting and so.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Now, this movie you mentioned, Eyes Wide Shut.
Mm.
You and Tommy. You and, I would say my Tommy, I just call him that affectionately.
Yes, he's your Tommy.
Thank you, Nicole! That's a great little spirit of generosity that I enjoy. He's my Tommy, and it's Valentine's Day, and I don't care what any of you people say. Yeah. Now, you guys play, it's a secret movie. It's coming out this summer.
No, it's not secret. It's just we haven't seen it yet, so it's very hard to talk about something that you haven't seen. It's coming out in July, yes.
And you guys play lovers who are, like, really intensely lovers or something. And there's, like, a lot
what?
Of... What? This is what I mean. You only get snippets. It's, like, a lot of nudity, eye voltage.
No. It's
no?
Just, it is what it is.
That's very vague.
I'm not sure what it is.
Really?
Yeah, no, we're going to see it in a couple of weeks, so then I'll be able to come back on the show and tell you all about it.
All right. You will.
Or he can come on. Then,
whatever. It's just as fun
much
to have
better.
You here.
No.
Just as much fun. You trust me. We're getting a Nicole Can You Hear Me song on my buttons very soon. We are. Now, I read in an interview similar to me, your mom did not let you play with Barbies when you were a kid.
Yeah.
Neither did my mom.
No.
Now, why didn't she let you?
Because she thought that it was sort of setting a... She thought that it was sexist and that, you know, that female form that was set by the Barbie doll was ridiculous.
Yeah, and non-attainable.
Yes.
Yes. But this
so
changed.
I wasn't allowed to play with them, but then I actually did a terrible thing. I stole one from a store.
Really?
Terrible. And I know, I was six. Yeah. I wanted one desperately, and I sort of put it in my bag and then went home and, being very honest, went, I took it, Mum, I took it, and she made me go back and give it back to the store.
Right.
She was dreadfully humiliating, crying, here's the Barbie. and then she did buy me one. So, because she said, all right, well, obviously, you know, you can't put your views and your political opinions already onto a child at six. I
mean, yeah. But my mom felt the same way.
Is it true that you're a Barbie?
I am a Barbie this Christmas.
Rosie's
and let me
Barbie.
Tell you, the Barbie has a double chin, honestly. I'm not kidding you. I made them make her have a little double chin and twice the size arms, and the waist does not go in, it goes straight down. I'm not kidding you.
Good, yes. Now, you've made it, but that means you've made it.
Well, you know, it's enjoyable to me.
You're huge
today.
If well, you're a Barbie.
Thank you, Nicole. Say that thing again about
I'm
Tommy
not worthy.
Being mine. No, say that thing about Tommy being mine again. Just say it one more time for me. Just come on.
No, I'm kissing your butt too much.
Oh! I wanted to give you this. Yes, you can. This is the Days of Thunder Barbie. It's not really. It's the NASCAR Barbie, but it's sort of when you met Tommy, the Days of Thunder Barbie. So because you never had one, I want to give you that.
Oh, and then, thank you.
Here you go. This is what I made for you. Because you're from Australia, I made you this.
What?
This is a throw the Barbie on the Barbie. Barbie, look. See? I made you a Barbie doll. Shish kebab. All right. Take that home. Have the babies play with that. It is disgusting, and I hope you enjoy it.
It's got onion, though.
It does. It's got onions, and don't eat that, or I'll take the Altoids if you do. I know that we will all watch you on the Tony Award. You are definitely going to be nominated. You are probably going to win. The Blue Room, the Court Theater, Nicole Kidman. I thank you very much. The party's in full swing out there. A few days ago, I sat down with some cutie patooties and we talked about their feelings about love, all for Valentine's Day. Take a look. Valentine's Day is almost here. We thought we'd ask some experts what they thought about love. Please welcome our kids, David, Brittany, Eliza, and Rocco. How's it going, kids? You ever been in love? Anybody here ever been in love?
I do. I was.
When?
I was.
I'm in love right now.
You are?
With Leonardo DiCaprio, Backstreet Boys, and Nolan.
And who was the last one?
Nolan.
Who's Nolan?
He's my boyfriend in class.
And he's right on up there with the Backstreet Boys and Leonardo DiCaprio?
Yep.
Oh, my goodness. When did you first fall in love with him?
In class.
Yeah? What happened? You just looked at him, you knew?
Yeah, he was so cute.
Really? Yeah. Is he friendly to you? Is he?
Yeah.
Does he treat you good? He treats you nice?
And he reads me books. Like, I know to read books to him, too.
You read books to each? What kind of books you read?
Maybe, like, chapter books or Harry...
You almost said Harriet the Spy?
Yeah, that's for you, right?
I know, you stopped. I saw you. You and Harriet the... Oops. Yeah, I was in that. Did you watch that movie?
Yeah.
Pretty good, huh?
It was nice.
Yeah, it was nice. Yeah. How about you? You in love, Rock?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? With him?
Since kindergarten.
Oh, my God, it's like forever. Since kindergarten, with who?
She's still in my class.
Oh, this sounds like it's got possibilities. What's her name?
Leda.
Layla? How'd you know she was the one for you, Rocco?
I don't know. I just keep on staring at her.
You do? Wow. And what does she do when you stare at her? What does she do?
Nothing. I just go like...
Does it scare her at all, Rocco?
No.
It doesn't scare her?
She said, hello?
You're in love. What kind of feelings do you have inside of you?
My heart was beeping.
Your heart was beeping? That's it? Just the heartbeat? That's all it took? Yeah. How about you, Eliza? Have you ever been in love, you think?
I think we're three people.
Three people? Which three?
Danny, a boy in my class, Angelo, a boy in my class, and Danny Zuko from Greece.
Danny Zuko! That would be John Travolta. He's about 48. Yeah. Now, how do you know you're in love? What kind of feelings you get inside of you?
Well, I sort of feel like I want to send him a Valentine's Day card.
Yeah.
And about Danny Zuko, because I like the swirl in his hair.
Yeah. Sometimes that's all it takes, ladies. A nice swirl in the hair, and you're doomed. How about you, David? In love, ever?
No.
Never yet, no. You saving yourself? For the perfect person for you? Yeah. How do you think you'll know when you meet that perfect person?
I don't know, when I'm in the sixth grade.
Yeah, when you're in the sixth grade, that's about the right time for you, huh? This is our Valentine's Day show, so look in that camera and say Happy Valentine's Day.
Happy Valentine's Day.
We'll be right back after this break, okay? Got together and recorded a CD. They received a Grammy and 4 hit singles. They did it again. The new CD, Trio 2. Please welcome Emmy Lou Harris, Linda Ronstadt, and Dolly Parton.
Trouble.
Happy 50th anniversary to the Bonadonnas. Happy anniversary.
That's so nice of you, Brendan. And is that the lunchbox you're signing for?
Yeah,
me?
I signed this, and I was hoping you could auction it off on eBay for the charity.
You know I will, Brendan.
You got
That's
it.
From your new movie. When's your movie open?
Last in the Past opens tonight and today. Please go see it. Very funny. And congratulations and all the best to the Bonadonnas.
All right, I'll be out there after the commercial. Stick around.
Yes,
you know, nice of him. He stopped by. Back with Dolly. Thank you so much for being here. I, for one, am thrilled that you made Trio 2. I so love Trio 1.
Good.
I really did. It's such a great... And I love the cover shots, just you as kids.
Right.
Whose idea was that?
Well, we didn't really have time to get together for a photo shoot.
We had 5 years, and then it was a rush.
And right, so it seemed like, well, let's just take some already existing pictures, and since everybody sort of knows what we look like, we thought it might be nice for people to see what we look like when we were so cute and unspoiled.
And you sure are cute and unspoiled in these photos. Now, how did the first CD come about? Who got together and said, let's do this?
We met sort of individually. I met Dolly on the Grand Ole Opry show. Emmy had met her.
And Linda and I knew each other. And
when we met, we said, who do you like? Whose singing do you like? And we said, Dolly's. And then Emmy had Dolly at her house, I think. You tell that.
Right. I had Dolly. Dolly came to visit me in L.A. after I'd met her in Nashville. And I called Linda up and said, Dolly's coming to my house. You have to come over.
I don't think I even stopped to put my shoes on. I
was really? Really
fast. And, yeah. And the first thing we did pretty much after just saying hi is sit down and sang. And it just was a glorious sound. And we loved the sound of it, and we knew that we wanted to make a record.
Did you argue about which songs to put on it?
No, we didn't argue. No. We just had, Emmy finds all these great songs.
The best songs.
So we just kind of all get together. And
We would just vote on them, which ones we wanted to do and which ones shimmered with the trio, because there are a lot of great songs that don't necessarily work in the context as a trio vehicle.
Yeah, we have a clip from 1977.
Yeah, this is about when we first started, long before the other trio album. Right. This is when we decided we had to do something together. We all looked pretty cute and funny.
All right, take a look right here.
Especially funny.
Sometimes say this of me, but I still think it of you. I think you guys are all friends. Like, I think, oh, it's Saturday night. Right now, the three of you are playing canasta. You know what I mean? Like, it would never occur to me that you didn't know each other beforehand. You know what I mean? Isn't that weird? People assume that.
Well, music does that. It brings people together.
I think there's a thing about being girl singers on the road, too. Like, you and I are single mothers. There's a thing you know. And I think there's a real sisterhood there.
Yeah, I agree. How are your babies?
They're great.
Are they great?
They're great.
Yeah, you're loving the motherhood thing as much as me?
I love it, but God, when I see other single mothers that don't have the kind of help and support that I have, I feel like I want to get down to my knees on them. You know, I have help and it's still so overwhelming.
Exactly.
And I'm just humbled by it.
Yeah, because people say to me all the time, Rosie, how do you do it? It's easy for me to do it because I have money, I have help.
Right.
It's how do the people do it who are really doing it?
You've got to find other people that know the way. I feel the same way about the Girl Singer thing. I always say, in Girl Singers Anonymous, I have Rosemary Clooney to be my sponsor because she's been down all the roads and all the side trails. You got to get somebody that's gone before you that knows, and you got to stay on the phone with them. And what do I do now? What do I do? She gave me advice about motherhood and singing. But don't you feel that way, that once you've been on the road and that's what you do, other people that have shared that experience become the wisdom that you seek.
Do you have somebody like that who you call up for advice or who you looked up to when you were growing and thought, that's who I want to be like?
Well, I actually have all that within my family because I have five beautiful sisters and my mom and my grandma, so I had all the advice I could handle.
Right. You had too
and
much
there's
advice.
There's 12 kids and there's 8 younger than me, so I grew up with bunches of kids all the time. But you was talking about us being friends and getting together on Saturday nights. We really are good friends and we do have a good time when we do get the opportunity to work together. And in the studio, we find time for our little fun stuff backstage, but I wish we all did have time, more time to spend together as girls and women and talk about our kids. And
have you all been to Dollywood?
Well, actually, I've played Dollywood, and I've eaten at Aunt Granny's.
That's a restaurant there on the grounds, Aunt Granny's restaurant. That's what all my nieces and nephews call me, is Aunt Granny.
Right.
Because, like I say, I don't have children of my own, but I'm everybody's mama.
Yeah.
She's raised most of her family.
I was going to say, you do not look like a grandmother, Dolly. I don't know where they get granny in there.
I don't feel like one, but I love the kids. I make a good aunt. I'd probably been a terrible mother, though. God knows
you
what
think
he's
you would have
doing.
Been a terrible mother?
I don't know. We'll never know, will we?
No, but why would you? Why
I'm
would you think
old
that?
To start now.
Would you think he just wouldn't have what? You...
Well, I don't know. I've never been pregnant. I used to want children when I was younger.
Right.
Now that I'm older, I feel like like I say, God has His plans, and He needed me to help with a lot of other folks' kids. I think.
I bet you would have been a great mother. I think you would have been a great mother too.
I guess
you're very warm.
All right, but, well, I would have been a friendly mother.
Yeah.
I'd have probably not been a good one. I'd have let him do everything I do, and that'd have been awful.
How are your kids?
My kids are great, but they're 28 and 19, so they're off on their own roads.
Yeah. Are they performing? Are they?
Well, I have my oldest daughter is studying graphic design. She's into the art thing, and then my youngest is interning at DreamWorks in Los Angeles, and she writes songs and does just about everything in the
music
business.
She writes wonderful songs.
Really?
Well, so she kind of left the nest early. She left a year early out of high school.
Right.
She was ready to leave Dodge and went to LA.
But she's doing well.
She's doing well.
It's a good ending to that story. Well, we're going to force you to sign many, many things. Dolly, I have one of your dolls in my collection. You signed the leg.
Yes, you signed the other leg.
Exactly. And we're going to put that up on eBay. We have all of my own personal albums of you guys, and we're going to have you sign them. And Emmy Lou gave me the pick and the trio. Just go on eBay.com. We'll raise a lot of money for charity. I thank you guys so much.
Well, thank you.
I'm so happy that you did another CD. Trio Kill, go buy it, will you? We'll be right back with our final check-in at the Bonadonna Party. We're back at the anniversary party. Are you guys having fun? Are you going?
No.
We're not going.
Work.
But they'll have fun.
But
we gotta
I'm
work.
Hungry.
And they're also gonna go, Al and Arlene, on an 8-day, 7-night cruise on Premier Cruise Lines on the
That I'm going on.
First of all.